75% of the flats will be sold under construction and 25% of the flats will be sold after construction, treating it as immovable property. The question comes whether Samrat Builders are liable to deduct TDS on the subcontract awarded to Unity Buildcon, and if yes, then how the TDS liability should be calculated since construction work and payment thereto will be made at different stages of construction, and there is uncertainty about the expectation which the builder has built up. This is a very practical difficulty, and there is no mechanism provided for deduction of TDS, and hence taking a practical view, as the speakers has mentioned in point number C, the tax should be deducted on the entire contract value to avoid any further litigation. Going to point number 6.5.
How can there be assumption?
We have taken a practical view, we have not assumed anything.
Only
practical. No assumption.
Objection. Outside the provision.
Outside.
Going to point number 6.5. Advance paid to contractor in Feb 30, 25 lakhs, out of which 15 lakhs is towards material mobilization advance and balance 10 lakhs towards contract. The contractor had issued RA bill of 8 lakhs in March 13, out of which 7 lakhs was certified and accounted. Income tax TDS has been deducted on whole 25 lakhs. First of all, there is wrong accounting going on here, since TDS has been deducted on the whole 25 lakhs. Secondly, the TDS, WCT TDS which should be deducted in accordance with section 31(1)(b)(2), wherein it clearly states that where any payment in nature of an advance payment towards execution of first contract is made by an employer to a dealer, and such amount is adjustable against the total contract value payable to the said dealer, then advance payment should be deemed to be the amount paid towards execution of the works contract only as and when such advance payment is adjusted in part or otherwise. Hence, TDS should be deducted on 7 lakhs only since it is certified and accounted.
So, there will be no TDS on advance?
No. Only on 7 lakhs which is certified, it will be deducted. Okay. Going to 6.6. Amar Enterprise have, I'll just summarize the question. Amar Enterprise has deducted TDS of their contractor Deep Enterprise. They have neither deposited the TDS in the government treasury nor issued TDS certificate. Deep Enterprise is only holding tax invoice from Amar Enterprise. Whether he can claim such TDS which is deducted, the only supporting for him is that the receipt which he has received in the bank is after deducting income tax TDS and WCT TDS. So, referring to section 31(4), the Deep Enterprise should claim the TDS at the initial point.
Okay.
And which Amar Enterprise has deducted. And he should wait till the time of assessment, since he should receive certificate as TDS is deducted during that particular period.
No, but if the certificate is not issued,
then he will have to pay off the liability at the time. Hmm?
Okay. Because the
merit
of TDS certificate not issued.
Once TDS certificate is not issued and he has neither paid, but suppose that the liability arises in after March, that return should be filed after March. So by the time TDS return will be filed for the period April to March in April. So he will receive TDS certificate.
He can claim the TDS credit in the month in which tax was deducted, and in 704 also he can show it as a pending TDS certificate. certificate yet to be received.
So it will be shown as pending.
Pending. Certificate is to be received and will compute the differential.
But then,
see, we will not compute at that time. In audit report, we will not compute our differential.
So
we show that.
Whether the contractee will be entitled to issue C form, if not, whether the main contractor can issue C form. The main contractor cannot issue C form under any circumstances. The contractee can issue C form subject to CST rules. Coming to next question, 7.2 and 7.3, which basically states that whether methods prescribed under the Local VAT Act can be used while computing liability under the interstate works contract. A common answer to again both the questions. Referring to my Patram case, in absence of any rule for determination of sales price in respect of transfer of property in goods involved in execution of works contract, the taxable turnover under CST Act cannot be taxable turnover under the CST Act cannot be left to the whims and fancies of the assessing authority, and hence such local rules shall apply. This is also supported with one more judgment in as referred by speaker in UP Sales Haryana.
Here, the
sector, so they will not be any tax on that 1 lakh as far as the point C is concerned. Now, would it make any difference if the subcontractor is discharging his tax liability on the taxable sale price of 6,30,000 following the Rule 58 table method? Here, 9 lakhs is the total cost for a subcontractor. He is paying tax on 6,30,000. See, total subcontractor is sale price for subcontractor is 6,30,000. Sale price for on 6,30,000 is paying the tax. And he is getting the balance and deduction from the from 9 lakhs. So the main contractor will get deduction of 9 lakhs. Main contractor will get a deduction of 9 lakhs as per rule. And on out of 1 lakh, he will get 30% deduction and the main contractor will pay the tax on 70,000. This is the view of our group. Since the TDS certificate has been issued by the employer in the name of main contractor, here the provision is that there is no provision in the law that whether if the main contractor gets a TDS certificate, whether he can transfer that certificate to the subcontractor. But in law, there is no any provision to transfer. In fact, as far as I feel it, and my group's opinion, the deduction will not be available as far as the TDS certificate is concerned. He has to claim refund against that particular TDS by claiming in his own region. If I go for the third method,
that case, the subcontract, the value, the bill which is raised by the subcontractor, I will get a deduction, no? See, when I will prepare my return, I will claim the deduction of the value of the bill of my subcontractor. If I reduce it, my liability will be only 2.
Third option is practical, but it is not correct legal presentation.
See, return requires some amendment because the return do not contain the such eventuality.
Goodbye at 7:15. In between there is a printer's meeting also. So what I am suggesting is that Pranav will sit in the printer's and he will deal with all these examples of main contractor and subcontractor. And wherever the queries are repetitive, we'll reply in the predators itself so that duplication cannot be, should be avoided. Will it be alright for you? Comments I'm giving. Comments I'm giving. I'm talking about these examples, etc. Main contractor, subcontractor, etc.
Principles.
Yeah. That I'm going to do it. I'm not going to leave it.
Don't leave it to Pranav.
No. How can it be? How can it be? Now, friends, Pranav, in his, thesis, preferred to write from 9 SDC to 65 VST. Straight away, I will go to the first principle which he referred to, and that is verse contract. What is verse contract? Now, if you remember 366-29A came in the definition clause whereby entry 54 with rate as tax on sale or purchase of goods is by virtue of this amendment expanded to include tax on the transfer of property in goods, whether as goods or in other form, involved in the execution of verse contract. Now, each word has its own impact on levy of tax. First of all, there has to be a property belonging to the third person or somebody else on which the contractor would be carrying on the work, may be movable, it may be unmovable. So then, that is the first principle, that a verse contract liable to tax cannot be on one's own property. One, that means if I have a plot of my own and if I am constructing my own for my own purpose, there cannot be any transfer of property from one person to another, and therefore there will be no liability under the Verse Contract Act. But I take another example, that after constructing that building,